close to you that I can come near to you. Miracle of miracle. Well, good morning. He is risen. Why don't you stand with us this morning? The Bible says, where two or more are gathered in my name, I will be there also. So whether we have two or whether we have 1,000, we're going to worship this God that raised Jesus from the life. Let's sing it out.
Hey!
listen to this account of the resurrection. But very early on Sunday morning, the women went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared. They found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. So they went in, but they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. As they stood there puzzled, two men suddenly appeared to them, clothed in dazzling robes. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground. Then the men asked, "Why are you looking among the dead for someone who is alive? He isn't here. He is risen from the dead. Remember what he told you back in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be betrayed into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and that he would rise again on the third day." Then they remembered what he had said. So they rushed back from the tomb to tell the 11 disciples and everyone else what had happened. He is our only King, and he will only always be the only King forever. Let's stand up.
Trust ever in your name, in the Jesus.
seated.
Amen. Good morning, church. Amen. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. We're here to celebrate that this morning. Amen. And it's good to see you this morning. I am Pastor Tony, one of the pastors here on staff here at Trinity. And we welcome you this morning. And if you would this morning, we'd love for you to take a moment of your time and grab a hold of that connection card if you're new to us here this morning and fill out as much information as you feel comfortable filling out today. Later in the service, we're going to receive his tithes and our offering. As the plate comes by as a guest this morning, we simply ask that you drop that connection card in there and allow us to get a chance to know you a little bit better and allow you to get a chance to know who we are here at Trinity a little bit better. And a couple things that we can point out to you this morning we want to highlight. First of all is our vision statement here at Trinity. That vision statement is this. If you know it, recite it with me here this morning. Is that we are here to reach people, to equip people, to reach people. That is simply all we're here to do, folks, and that is our vision statement here at Trinity. And we believe that everything that we do here is really coming off of that vision statement. That's what we base everything off of, because that's our commission, is that we want to reach people, to equip people, to reach people. And that next step for you here at Trinity is to do this, is to get involved in Life Group. If you haven't been part of Life Group, you don't know what Life Group's about, you don't know anything about it, then please get with me after the service. We'd love to get you plugged in, give you some options, give you the opportunity to get plugged into Life Group, because we believe that is a next step to helping you to grow in your Christian walk. And believe me, it's been beneficial for me not only to be a part of that, but also to be fortunate enough to be able to lead a group. So that is fantastic, and we trust that you would benefit out of that as well. So again, welcome here to Trinity. We hope you have a blessed day today, this Easter Sunday.
Why don't you stand with us? He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. He has so many names that we can't even comprehend them all. But the one glorious thing is we get to worship Him who is worthy of His name.
Rumors of the Son of Man, stories of the Savior, holiness with human hands, treasure for the traitor. No ear had heard, no eye had seen the image of the Father, until living came to live with me, a rescue like no other. You are Redeemer, my answer, my saving grace.
Thank you. It is by you and you alone that we get to come to the Father. Lord, as Pastor Steve talked about on Good Friday, it's not just that you paid a little bit. It's that you paid the whole sacrifice for us. Us, your children. Thank you so much that when we get to sing, we get to sing about the hope that you paid it all. And it is well with our soul. Let's sing this out.
Amen, amen. Is it well with your soul this morning? Amen. You may be seated. Let's pray together. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, you know that verse, that song has been resonating with me for a while now. And I love the progression of the understanding that it was not just a part of our sin, but the whole sin that was nailed to the cross. And I love the blessed assurance that we can proclaim this morning that those who believe in you as their Lord and Savior, that we do not need to bear our sin any longer. That you bared it for us on the cross. But also, Lord, it speaks to this return. That you are the King of kings, the Lord of lords, and that you were resurrected. And that is what we celebrate today, Lord. And now we wait in the already, but not yet. The anticipation, Lord, of your return. As we already sang about, the sky will be torn open, the trumps will resound, and you will descend. We are thankful this morning for that promise. We're thankful for your cross. We're thankful for the empty tomb. And we're thankful for what you plan to do in and through each of us this morning. Lord, to be a church with the desire to pray for other churches this morning, we come to you and we pray here locally in Naperville for the Holy Spirit Catholic community and Pastor Dennis. Lord, I pray that as churches are gathered around the world this morning to proclaim your name, to proclaim your resurrection. And we also pray for the Holy Spirit Catholic community this morning here in Naperville, who is proclaiming your name as well. Jesus, my heart is overwhelmed with the desire and the necessity, I believe, this morning for us to pray for the protection of your church. We know that there are many right now in the world that are against you and against your church and against your people. So Jesus, I pray for protection over our churches all across the world. That people can go and knowing that it's probably going to cost them their life, that they would go with great boldness to know that greater are you in them than he that is in the world. Jesus, as we continue to pray for our churches that we partner with here at Trinity and our Nazarene churches on our district, Chicago Central District, we pray for Reach 77 this morning. Reach 77 is an incredible ministry, a heart for the city of Chicago to reach into each of the 77 neighborhoods of that city. Jesus, I pray for Lauren Seaman this morning. I ask, Lord, that you would be just enveloping him with your Holy Spirit. May he be anointed with the decisions that need to happen in order to navigate the incredibly rough and tough waters of the city. Lord, I pray for the Ribas. I pray for the Lilies. I pray for the families that are moving into the city with the intentionality of beginning your work in places that has not seen it for years. And Lord, this morning as we continue to pray for missionaries around the world, we lift our Nazarene missionaries in Hungary, Martin and Cesarina Glendening. Lord, we lift them up to you. We pray, Lord, in Hungary, we know that they are dealing with cultural wars and refugees and people that are trying to escape ISIS, and they're running, they're scared, and they're desperate. Lord, what a great opportunity to share with them the love that only you can truly provide. As they're running from danger, as they're running from death, I pray that they run into your arms, into life, and into hope. So Jesus, we pray for the Glendennings this morning and ask for your anointing to be upon them as they do your work, and they are your hands and your feet in Hungary. And Jesus, as we continue through the receiving of your tithes and our offering, Lord, I pray that you would continue to richly bless us this morning. We're praying for May 21st. We're lifting May 21st up to you because we know it's our desire to reach our goal for Power of One of 40,000 dollars. Lord, we want to challenge, you are challenging our hearts to step out in faith and to trust you with our finances. So Lord, may we prepare, maybe we prepare to give and to give out of sacrifice and to give boldly, not just on May 21st, but maybe even this morning, Lord, as you lead our hearts. We thank you for your provision. We thank you that you've given us 100% and you call us to steward 90 well. And so Jesus, it's to you that we pray all these things. We pray for your anointing on the rest of our service this morning. May you be glorified. May you be high and lifted up. May we not forget that you are resurrected this morning and you call us to live resurrected lives. So again, we pray this all in your name. Amen. Well, I don't want you to miss the opportunity before you to hear my message in 5 minutes. It's an opportunity. It truly is. So I'm going to actually go through my message. I'm going to give you my entire message in 5 minutes. Are you ready? Here it is. God, in our sin, where God created us to be with Him. He created us to be in, with Him in relationship. But because of our sin, there we go. Because of our sin separated us from God. And so since we now have this sin, our sins cannot be removed by good deeds. There's nothing that we can do to earn our salvation, as you heard me say on Friday, as we stand before the redemption room and we look at the tickets we have in our hand and we look at the top prize of salvation and forgiveness. There is nothing that we can do to earn the top prize. We are in need of a Savior. And so with that, we understand that there was a payment that needed to be made. So paying the price, Jesus died and rose again. Isn't that good news? So now that we understand that God built us for relationship, he created us for relationship, our sin has separated us, and sins now are filthy, our good deeds are like filthy rags in comparison to what and who God is. We need Jesus to pay that atoning sacrifice for us, and not just die, but to rise as well. And so because of that, everyone who trusts in Him, everyone who trusts in Him has eternal life. And here's the last part, the life with Jesus. It starts now. It starts now. And it continues or lasts forever. This is good news. This is good news. So if you're tracking with that, that's literally my sermon in 5 minutes right there. We can all go home. But y'all came for more, right? Y'all came for more. You're like, yes, but not too much more. Right? So if we look at it, we break it down like this. It's gospel. What I just walked through with you is my heart's desire that you would store in your heart. Not just as a personal testimony of your own individual salvation, which God has worked in you, but that you would have a tool to be able to walk someone else through. And they'll ask you, what makes you so different? Why is it that when everybody's getting demoted or everybody's taking pay cuts, you're kind of just like, oh, it's okay, it'll be all right. Why is it you act that way? And you can say, well, let me tell you. It's because of the gospel. It's because of the gospel. It's because of what Jesus, He started in me. And He's even told me that He'll see it unto completion. Amen? Amen. I was a youth pastor, as you know, and one of the times that we were traveling, we took our kids to youth camp up in Lake Geneva. So we went to Lake Geneva Bible Camp, and it was a wonderful place to go, and they had a high ropes course. How many of you have ever done a high ropes course? Yeah, high ropes courses are pretty cool. It's a leadership type of thing, you know, and it's pretty fun. And so I'm standing there, and you have to know two things about me. I fear two things. I fear heights, and I fear death due to heights. Those are the two things. I don't fear death in itself because, I pray that I'm ready, you know. But I definitely fear the result of death because of heights, because I have this deathly fear of heights. I love roller coasters, and people always ask me, like, how do you love roller coasters but you hate heights? And I'm like, well, it's because I know that when I go up, you know, what goes up is going to come down, right? So I just endure the up so I can get to the down part, which makes it even more exhilarating for me. So I have these two fears, and I remember standing there, and this little tiny college girl comes walking up, and she's all perky and everything, and I'm still a little hesitant, right? So you know those people, right? They're like, they're always happy, they're always smiling, chipper, and then you get a person like me who's kind of like, I'm not really sure about this, like, I got to go up there, is that what you're telling me? And she's like, here's your harness, right? And she gives me this harness, she goes, you put it on like a diaper, right? And I'm thinking to myself, at the end of this, I'm going to need a diaper. Right? So I get this thing on me, right? And then now I realize, I'm like, wait, I gotta be tough. I got to be tough for my kids. I got to be tough for my kids, right? Because I'm the youth pastor. So if I get scared, they'll get scared, you know? So I'm acting all tough for my kids. And then all of a sudden I realize that this college kid is going to be my belay, right? You know, a belay is the person who holds on to the end of the rope. And they're the ones that you go out onto the nothingness, right? And then they're down on the bottom and they're feeding rope and line and everything. And I'm thinking to myself, I was like, I got to be tough for my kids, but a kid's going to be the one that's belaying me this morning. I'm like, oh my word, what in the world are we doing here? So you know, I start to ask questions. I get a little nervous. When I get nervous, I ask questions, right? So I ask them, so how long have you been doing this, you know? And she goes, oh, sir. She's like, and it's always a bad sign when they call you sir. She says, oh, sir, I've been doing this all summer. And what's right on through my mind is, it's only June. So, how much experience do we have here doing this, right? And I'm like, you know, you never want to ask a woman how much she weighs, but it was just a concern. It was a concern of mine, you know? I mean, she's 5'4", and you know, I mean, I'm not. And so I ask her this next question, because this is the critical question that you need to ask before going onto a high ropes course. How is it that I don't die? Right? That's the critical question. How is it that I don't die? And she looks at me with all the confidence in the world. Oh, sir, that's not your job. That's mine. Oh, okay. Okay. Thanks. Perfect. So I get all harnessed up and I get all ready to go, and I start the ascent up to the top, and we start to go off, and I'm doing the different little apparatuses, you know, as you're going, and all the different little courses and stuff, and I'm good. I'm like, this isn't bad, you know, and I'm trusting the belay and everything else and the rope and the harness, and you know, if I start going through the checklist of things I have to trust, I'm kind of, whoa, wait a minute, you know, is this harness, this is, okay, good, we're good. And the rope, yeah, the rope is good. You know, how old is this rope, really? I mean, if you think about it, how many people have used this? I'm wearing this helmet. Will this helmet actually stop my head from cracking like an egg if I fall? You know, because it doesn't look very sturdy. I mean, these are all the things that start running through your head. So I'm good, but I'm conquering my fears, you know. Until the last apparatus. It's called the leap of faith. How many of you ever have participated in this leap of faith? Okay, Larry, thank you, Larry. Larry knows what I'm talking about. Right now, Larry and I, we have a connection. We have a bond. Because basically, essentially, the leap of faith is you climbing up to the top of a telephone pole. Not essentially, it is. You climb onto the top of a telephone pole, and you stand up there, right? And you're like literally like 40 feet in the air. And the goal is to leap out and grab a hold of this trapeze bar that they strategically put too far away, because the goal is not necessarily to grab a hold of the trapeze bar. It's to have the faith that the belay and the rope and the harness and the buckle are all going to work, right? And so I'm up there, and I'm sitting there, and I'm like, you know, and then I'm thinking to myself, I can't climb down, because that's called the climb of shame. You know what I mean? And I'm a youth pastor, right? So all my kids are like, what's wrong, Pastor Steve? You know what I mean? And I'm like, oh, my word. So I had to do the leap of faith. So all of a sudden, I'm on the edge of this telephone pole. Does the telephone pole have an edge? I mean, think about it. So I'm like, the telephone pole's underneath me, and I've got to leap out and grab hold of this fictitious trapeze bar. It's there, but it's not meant to catch you. And all of a sudden you jump out, man, and there's this exhilaration. But the exhilaration doesn't come in the leaping out part. The exhilaration comes when the rope catches, and the harness holds, and the buckle stays sure and true, you know? That's when the exhilaration, because all of a sudden you're like, I'm alive, you know what I mean? Like, that's the best part of the experience. So then you come down, and they bring you down, and little 5'4 college intern, she's like, see, sir, wasn't that great? And I was like, yeah, that was great, you know? Oh, my word, you're killing me here. Holy smokes. I'm actually getting hot just thinking about it. Whew. So, I remember having that 316 moment with her. Have you ever had a 316 moment? You know, whoever trusts in whatever's happening hopefully won't die today. You know, that's what I had with this little tiny college intern who literally held my life in her hands. And the reality is, I was kind of going through this mental jumping jack, thinking to myself, I'll believe it when I see it. Now, the reality for us this morning is, don't we treat Jesus in the same way? Don't we treat Jesus in the same way? We kind of go into the mentality with Jesus, I'll believe it when I see it. And the great news for us this morning is that Jesus has accounted for this. He's accounted for our understanding and our lack of faith sometimes to really get to the place where, you know, faith is believing without seeing. But he accounted for it. In fact, think about Thomas. Think about doubting Thomas's response. He's dejected. He's upset. He just had his world turned upside down. And he's in this upper room area, probably where they had the Last Supper. And he's just probably just beside himself going, what in the world just happened? Our master, our rabbi, our supposed savior died. He didn't come down off the cross. He's dejected. And I can just see him pounding his fist on the table and saying, you know what? These ladies come back with this story about how Jesus is resurrected and he's not there. And you know what? I'll believe it when I touch his hands, when I put my finger in his side. Then I'll believe. Remember what Jesus says in John 20, verse 27. He says, don't be faithless any longer. Believe. Don't be faithless any longer. Believe. You see, because Jesus did show up in that room. And Jesus did come to Thomas and say, Thomas, I know that you have doubt. And Jesus put his finger on Thomas's doubt and he said, it's this lack of faith. He says, don't be faithless anymore. Believe. And then in verse 28, Thomas says, I love these words, my Lord and my God. Because he had Jesus standing before him in that moment. How awesome is that? Jesus looks at him in verse 29, and Jesus told him, you believe because you have seen me. Blessed are those who believe without seeing me. So that's a verse for us. We don't have the opportunity to physically see Jesus before us. Not necessarily in the sense that the disciples had in that moment when he came into the upper room, Thomas was able to touch his side. So he says, blessed are we in this room this morning, for if we have faith to believe without seeing, it's even more blessed than it is to believe just because we saw. The scripture this morning is maybe for some of us anticlimactic because it's John 3:16. John 3:16 is one of the most recited verses in all the Bible. It's one of the most advertised verses. You always see the green neon sign behind the field goal post, right at the football games. On one side, it's an arrow. So when the opposing team is kicking, you know, the arrow goes like this, because that's going to throw the kicker off, right? And then on the other side, it says 3:16. It's meant to incite people to go, what is 3:16? And to look at this passage of Scripture in John 3. My hope is that when people see 3:16, they don't just read John 3:16. My hope is that they read all of chapter 3 of John, because there's amazing things that are happening in that conversation. But for many of us, we know John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Really, if you think about it, that is the gospel in a verse. It's the gospel in a verse, because I don't want you to miss the progression that's there for us to learn from. The first point is that God loves. God loves. He didn't send his son just to appease himself. He didn't send his son just because he thought it was a good idea. He didn't send his son to please us. He sent his son because he loves us. And the second point of that is, because he loves us so much, he sent the most precious and sacred thing that he could, his one and only son. And who is that? Jesus. So then the progression number three is that whoever believes in his son, in Jesus, will move on to number four, won't die. Now that sounds like a pretty good thing in itself, won't die. But there's a fifth part. It's not just about not dying. It's about living in relationship with Christ forever. Not being separated from God. You see, that's the amazing part about Easter is not just celebrating the death on Good Friday, but the resurrection on Sunday. And that we get to live, not just recognize that I'm crucified with Christ, that we too are nailed to the cross with our Savior, because our sins is what held him there, but that we too, through his power, through his death and his resurrection, can live resurrected lives. That's good news. That's good news. So there's a variation on one word that I want to kind of look at this morning. It's the word believes. It says, for God so loved the world that he sent his one and only son, that whoever believes. Now, the iteration on this word in the Greek actually also has this kind of line to it, but it's not just belief, it's trust. It actually says to trust in, to put our trust in. So believes actually only tingles the intellectual side. But when we look at to trust in, that's actually putting our belief in action. It's doing something with that belief. It's not just believing in Jesus, but it's actually living your life as if that were true in you. So for us, I know, and I'm just going to call it out this morning, trust is hard. Trust is hard. If we think about it, trust is something that we think is really hard, especially in relationship with Jesus. But the truth is, we do it every day. We do it every day. Now, I'm going to ask for a volunteer, someone to come and simply, all you need to do this morning is trust me. That's it. So, can I have a volunteer? Awesome, Chris. Thank you, sir. Let's give Chris a hand. Now, I want you just to stand here. Just stand here. Now, turn around. Turn around. No, yeah, the other way around. Okay. There we go. You're the other way. All right, perfect. All right, now, Chris, I just have a question. Do you trust me?
Yes.
Oh, there was like a slight pause. It's a little, I heard it. But that's okay. That's okay because you don't have to trust me. Do me a favor, just sit down. Well, you looked first. Well, no, stand back up. You looked first.
Yes.
What was that about?
Just making sure.
All right, just making sure. Okay, so we'll try this again. Here we go. Chris, do you trust me?
I trust you.
Oh, well, now you trust me, right? Well, because you already tested the chair. You already knew that the chair is going to hold you, right? I mean, it was like kind of like cheating. You know, think about it.
Well, I've been gaining weight. I wanted to make sure I did.
That's perfect. Okay, so now, the goal is you don't have to trust me. All you have to do is trust the chair. So go ahead and just sit down for me. Awesome. Now, any issues? No creaks, no movement. This is perfect, right? Now, would you have any problem sharing with anybody else in the room that what you just did is perfectly safe? Would you have any hesitation?
No,
right? Why is that?
Because I've experienced it.
Because you've experienced it and you're okay. Awesome. Thank you. Let's give Chris a hand. Trust is something that we do every day. Think about that in your own life. How often do you sit down in a chair and you don't necessarily, now I set Chris up for a little bit of failure there because he was like, wait a minute, there's got to be a catch, right? But think about when you walked into the room this morning, did you have to look down at your pew before you sat down? No, you just sat down. But why? Because you sat on that pew before, or you sat on something like it, or you've seen chairs, and you don't test the sturdiness of a chair before you sit down, you just sit down. And then because of your experience being able to sit in that chair, you have no problem sharing with anybody else in the room or the area, hey, listen, you too can sit in this chair. It's safe. But why is that? Because I've experienced sitting in this chair, and I can tell you, it'll hold you up. is the dashboards of your spiritual life going off right now? Are the lights on your spiritual dashboard starting to go off? Are you seeing where I'm going with this, folks? Because trust is something that we do every day. We trust all the time. My favorite analogy for trust is this one. I love sharing this. You go to a doctor whose name you can't pronounce, whose degree that you've never verified. They give you a prescription that you can't read or understand. You take it to a pharmacist who you've never met. They give you a chemical compound. Confused by the way it works, you go home and you put the compound in your body according to the little instructions written on a tiny bottle. Does anybody else see a problem with this? But we do it all the time. And why? Well, because the last time I had this issue, I went to a doctor whose name I couldn't pronounce. I didn't verify his credentials. He gave me a prescription for this compound, and I took it to a pharmacist. I've never met the pharmacist before. And all of a sudden, I put that compound in my body, and according to the instructions written in the tiny little letters on a tiny little bottle. And I'll do it again. Why? Because after I took the prescription, it helped me to feel better. You see, trust is something that we do every day, but it's hard. It's hard. In fact, I wish it were that easy. When we look at John 3:16, that word believes. We want to make that word harder. Think about it this way. That whoever works for him shall not perish. You see, in our minds, we tend to want to jump to the harder piece, like whoever works for him, then they won't perish. Or maybe it's not works for him, maybe it's gives to. Whoever gives to him, because we tend to think that if I just give enough, then I'll earn favor with God. And surely if I was to perish, I'll go to everlasting life. I'll get to heaven because I gave. Folks, sometimes we tend to think that our responsibility is to satisfy. So sometimes we look at it and we go, whoever satisfies him will not perish. And then my favorite, attends church. Whoever attends church the most wins. No, folks. See, it's not about any of those things. It's not about working. It's not about giving. It's not about satisfying. It's not about attendance. Because that's not the way it works. We always feel like we have to do more, but the truth is, we simply need to believe. We need to believe and to trust in the death and the resurrection of Jesus. You see, that trust needs to be in Christ and in Christ alone. So let's put ourselves in the shoes of the disciples. Here's the reality about the disciples. The disciples did not put their trust in a religion. They did not put their trust in a religion. They put their trust in Jesus. They were all in with Jesus. And the reason that we know that they were all in with Jesus is because they were willing to die for him. Josh McDowell says, many will die for what they think to be true, but nobody's willing to die for what they know to be a lie. Think about the disciples. Every single disciple was tortured and killed. They were martyred for their faith. They were crucified upside down. They were beheaded. They were split open. They were tortured. Now, think about that. Think about it for a second. Would they be willing to do that for what they know not to be true? Would they be willing to go to that length if they had a question in their mind whether or not Jesus really met with them in the upper room or traveled with them for 3 days or 3 years? See, the reality for us this morning is we can't put our faith in a religion. We have to put our faith in Jesus Christ. In Jesus, in him and him alone. My son loves to test my faith. He tests his faith too. You see, because Parker, ever since he was a little guy, he would always do, we have this game. In fact, we still do it even today. He'll say, hey, daddy. And wherever I'm at in the room, I need to be prepared because it means he's in the air. So he'll jump off of couches, stairs, playground equipment. I mean, and I'll just be walking around. All of a sudden, I'll hear, "Hey, Daddy," and I got to turn because he's like, you know, I mean, he's coming at me. He trusts the fact that I'm going to catch him every time. Even now, you know, you'll even see him sometimes. He'll back way up. He'll back up, and all of a sudden, he comes running full steam at me, and he leaps in the air. And the reality is, if I don't catch him, he's going to hurt himself. But he trusts. He has faith that his daddy is going to catch him. And he has that trust because, well, I haven't dropped him yet. But there definitely have been times where I'm like, Parker, you got to give me some warning, bud. You know what I mean? And he's like, what? That's fine. You know what I mean? Like, oh, yeah, until we're both in the emergency room. But think about it. He has no doubt that I'll catch him. You see, childlike faith is a requirement for eternal life. So let's talk about that. Let's talk about life for a second here. You know, advertising, they do an incredible job communicating life. I didn't say they do a good job, but they do an incredible job. I mean, think about some of the things that they communicate to you. They communicate that life is lived around a beer, that a beer can foster a relationship. Or that a car, Hyundai has gotten on this bandwagon where they're actually communicating that a car can make you a better parent. Right? It's true. Or that a Fitbit is going to make you more healthy. Right? So they tell you that life is lived out, you know, outdoors, and life is lived here. So just get a Fitbit and you'll go outside more. Right? But the reality is when we step back and we look at the difference between the fiction of advertising and the reality, it's that relationships take time and they take commitment. Folks, a car is not going to make you a better parent. Parenting is hard. And just because you wear a Fitbit, it doesn't make you more healthy, because a Fitbit isn't going to walk all those or run all those miles for you. There's a part that you still have to do. So let's not confuse the world's definition of life and God's definition of life. You see, because the world would define life as do this. The world would define life as get this. Or here's a way that you can live your life. And if you just act this way, then you'll have a full and abundant life. But then God's definition of life is John 10:10. You see, the thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came, meaning Jesus, that they may have life and have it abundantly. You see, that word life there is not bios. It's not a biological life. That word life there in the Greek is zoe. Zoe life, meaning new life. I came that they would have new life. And not just a little bit of it, but all of it, to the fullest, abundantly. Jesus offers Zoe life. Jesus talked less about the duration of life. And instead, he talked a whole lot more about the quality, about the energy, and about the fulfillment of life. The challenge for you that I have this morning is, how full is your life? How much fulfillment are you getting out of your life? Because if you're leaning on the world to fill you, all it's going to do is drain you empty. But if you lean on Christ to fill you, he will fill you to overflowing. That's the difference. A few weeks ago, we talked about the fact that God breathed his life into us. He spoke all of creation into existence with his words. He spoke them, and they happened. But with us, he stopped. He got down in the muck and the mire. He breathed into the ground, and his breath entered into humanity. We are the only beings on this planet that have God's breath in them. God's breath is in each and every one of us this morning. You bear the breath of God. And because of God's breath in Adam and Eve, and because of God's breath in you and in me, more than just Adam and Eve's physical bodies died in the garden. Go back to the garden and think about what happened when Eve ate the fruit. And then when Adam ate the fruit, did their physical bodies die in that moment? No. But Jesus said that you'll surely die if you eat the fruit. So we have to ask and answer the question, what died when they ate the fruit? The result is the nephesh. The nephesh, the soul, the relationship with God is what died in the garden. They experienced death. And their souls were now separated from God, and that relationship was broken. That's what died in the garden. Genesis 2:17 says that if you eat from the fruit, you're going to die. You see, in the garden, God gave Adam and Eve the keys to a really expensive and beautiful creation. He gave them the keys, and he's like, all right, now, don't wreck it. And Adam and Eve, they took the creation for a joyride, and what did they do along the way? They wrecked it. It's no wonder they hid. It's no wonder they hid. God gave them the keys. He gave them one rule, just don't mess it up. And the first thing they did was they messed it up. And so they hid out of shame because they realized what they had done. And ever since then, we have been standing outside the gate of the garden, looking into the garden, realizing that we want that back. We want the restoration of that relationship back. You see, we realize deep down, every single person in this room has gotten to the place where we too realize that something isn't right. Something is off. Something is, I have all that I could ever want even or imagine, but yet it's still, I don't feel fulfilled. Well, why is that? Because you don't have Jesus. Because the relationship is still broken. And you desire deep down in your heart to have that relationship restored. So how do we go about doing that? I mean, folks, listen. Your heart may be pumping. Your brain might be firing. Your limbs might be moving. But let me tell you, it doesn't mean that you're alive today. It doesn't mean that you're alive today. This is what Jesus meant in John chapter 3 when he was talking to the Pharisee Nicodemus. He looked at Nicodemus and he says, Nicodemus, you won't experience the kingdom of God unless you're born again. And we hear this language, born again, a lot. And the truth is, don't worry, Nicodemus was just as confused as maybe some of us are. We're like, wait a minute. Nicodemus is like, how is this going to work? How's an old man going to crawl back up into his mother's womb? I mean, that's kind of like, you know, could you imagine that conversation? That's what Nicodemus asked. And Jesus is going, I can imagine him kind of like chuckling, you know. No, Nicodemus. Let me tell you this. He says, unless you believe in me, unless you understand what I've come to do, then and only then can you experience eternal life. John 17:3 says, and this is the way to have eternal life, to know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, the one you sent to earth. To know Jesus and his Father. That is the only way. Here Jesus is in the garden in John 17 and he's praying to his Heavenly Father and he's saying the only way that you can experience eternal life is to know God and to know his Son who he sent and what he did for us. 1 Peter 1, 3 through 4. I love the message version of this. It says, what a God we have and how fortunate we are to have him. This Father of our Master Jesus, because Jesus was raised from the dead, we've been given a brand new life and have everything to live for. I know that there's times, or maybe there's some of us this morning, we've gotten to the place in our lives and we've asked the question in our minds and in our hearts, is it really worth living for? And here Jesus is saying to us, here we're learning because Jesus was raised from the dead, we've been given a brand new life and we have everything to live for, including a future in heaven. And the future starts now. So here's the last word I want us to consider as we begin to close. And I'm just going to ask Angie to come and just to play quietly. Here's another word to consider. Whoever. In John 3:16, it says that whoever believes, whoever puts their trust in him. Because of God's free gift of salvation through his Son, Jesus Christ, everyone, everybody say everyone, everyone has the opportunity for eternal life. See, 2 Peter 3:9 reminds us of God's passion. God's passion is that none would perish. He wants to see everybody experience this eternal life. But it doesn't change the fact that we have to realize that there are some, there are many who are not experiencing that eternal life because they're choosing not to. See, God's heart, God's passion is that none would perish. But it doesn't change the fact that some are and some will. And so our heart, our passion needs to be able to share the gospel with them. Here's the thing. Everyone includes you. You are everyone. It includes you. So I want to end by just reading in Mark's gospel, the resurrection account. It's very, very short, but it's incredibly significant, especially to one of the disciples. And if we're not careful, we'll actually miss it. You can actually miss the gravity of this account in Mark. So in Mark chapter 16, verses 5 through 7, it says, "When they entered the tomb, they saw a young man clothed in white robes sitting on the right side. The women were shocked, but the angel said, 'Don't be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He isn't here.'" Isn't that good news? "He is risen from the dead." And everyone said, "Amen. Look, this is where they laid his body. Now go and tell his disciples, including Peter, that Jesus is going ahead of you to Galilee. You will see him there, just as he told you before he died." Here's the amazing thing about that. See, if we're not careful, we're going to miss the gravity of this incredible account. Because the angel said, "Go and tell the disciples," and then he sets aside Peter, and he says, "including Peter." And now you might be asking yourself, well, Pastor, why is that significant? It's significant for us this morning because 3 days before this happened, Peter denied that he was even a disciple. And he did it. We tend to think that it was away from Jesus. It was easy for Peter to do because he wasn't even near Jesus. I mean, he was in the temple area, but it wasn't in front. But the reality is when we search the scripture, we recognize that Peter denied Jesus to his face. That in that moment, Jesus heard Peter deny him. And so I want you to imagine this scene with me. The disciples are in that room. They're upset. They're distraught. Life has just crushed them. You ever been there? They're grieved by what's going on around them. Have you ever been there? They're beside themselves and have no faith anymore. Their hope is gone. And all of a sudden, these women come bursting into the room out of breath after running from the tomb. You're not going to believe this. Jesus isn't in the tomb. They're like, and the disciples are like, "What? What? Get out of here. This is some sick joke. Are you serious?" And then the women are there and they're standing there and they're going, "No, we went and there was this angel and he showed us the grave clothes. He's not there. And then Peter probably says, "Well, did the angel say anything?" And all of a sudden the women look at him and they said, yes. "He said to tell you all." And then they look at Peter and they said, "And make sure that you tell Peter." And in that moment, Peter realizes that God hadn't forgotten him. God hadn't forgotten him. God didn't miss Peter. Because he knew what Peter was experiencing. He knew what Peter was going through. He knew what Peter needed in that moment. See, this is good news for you and for me because it means that Jesus offers hope and forgiveness to all who have failed God. Jesus offers faith, and he offers hope and forgiveness to all who have failed God. Have you ever failed God? Maybe the better question is, when was the last time you failed God? Can I just tell you that he offers you hope? He offers you forgiveness. That he says to you, and we'll see in John 21 that Jesus restores Peter. He restores Peter in John 21. He asks Peter three questions. How many times did Peter deny him? Three times. Jesus restored Peter in that moment because God's heart is that none would perish. Through his Holy Spirit, he has gone before each and every one of us in this space this morning and desires for you to hear the forgiveness and the hope that he has for you. You see, the reality is, when we read that scripture, we can really read it like this. Now go and tell his disciples, including you, insert your name there. Go and tell his disciples, including Steve. Go and tell his disciples, including Pastor Katie. Go and tell his disciples, including Aaron. Go and tell his disciples, including Lucy. See, that's the way we can understand the power of this passage, is that he desires that we all would come into that relationship with him and see it restored through his son, Jesus. To recognize that the cross was powerful and important, but his resurrection brings new life. When was the last time that you failed God? When was the last time that you too asked all the questions? Is this safe? Will this rope hold me? Will this harness keep me above instead of being down on the ground? Will this buckle really hold if I was to make that leap of faith? Folks, there are many in this place. There are many in this place who have been where you are, and they've put their faith and their trust in God. And there are many that could stand here just like me and proclaim to you this morning that you can trust in Jesus, because he has never dropped anyone, and he doesn't plan to start. Would you stand with me as we close this morning? Maybe there's some this morning who are struggling with the reality that you've been able, that the Holy Spirit's been able to speak into you this morning, and you realize that your relationship with Christ is broken. And it's a result of the sin, and maybe even the faithlessness. Maybe it's the recognizing that maybe you've treated Jesus that in the sense of, I'll believe it when I see it. Let me just reaffirm in you, blessed is he who believes without seeing. So maybe if that's you this morning, and you say, Pastor, I want to work on that relationship. I want to work on seeing that restored, and I recognize that the only way is through Jesus. Would you just do me a favor right now? Would you just step out where you are? Would you just step out and come down to this place of grace, to the altar? Would you just say, you know, I want to work on that relationship. I want to see that restored. I recognize that the sin in my life has broken that relationship. And you want somebody to pray with you. Would you just step out? And we're going to have pastors come, and they're going to gather with you, and they're just going to simply pray with you. Just a prayer of encouragement. Maybe for you this morning, you recognize that you're in need of salvation, and you haven't trusted your life with the risen Savior. As we pray and as we close, I'm just going to ask for some of the pastors to come down and to pray with those who have stepped forward. So I'm going to invite you to come now and to pray with them. And then we're just going to simply close our service this morning in prayer. And we want to give you the opportunity, again, if during this time that you would like to pray, we want to invite you to come. We want you to come. And so, Lord Jesus, we come before you. We thank you for your salvation. We thank you, Lord, that this morning that we are new creations, that you desire to give us eternal life, and not just life a little, but life a lot, that you desire to have an abundant life in us, that we too this morning can experience the resurrection. Maybe for some of us this morning, we're seeing it all new. So Lord, if that is us, I pray, Jesus, that your heart would reach into our heart and that we would be open and receptive to what you desire to do. For others, Lord, this morning, we've made this decision. This decision is one that we made a long time ago. And so this morning, we're working on the relationship to continue to build and strengthen that relationship. And I pray, Lord, that you would put a holy fire in our bellies, a passion to be able to share and proclaim this gospel out to a world that is so desperately in need of it. So, Lord, we thank you for this Resurrection Sunday. We thank you for Easter. We thank you that we can leave here knowing that we are new in you. So now, Trinity, I just invite you to open your hands and just to receive this benediction as we close. And as we go, I just ask that you would go quietly this morning, just in reverence to allow those who are praying to continue to pray. And if you want to come while everybody's going out, if you just want to come forward and you just want prayer this morning, just step forward and we will pray with you this morning. Would you say this with me as we close? And may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, amen and amen. You are sent.